Hello, everybody. We want to welcome you to Iron on Iron Bible Study. We're studying 2 Samuel. This week we're in chapter 18. We're getting close to the end of this book. And when we wrap it up here in probably the next couple of weeks, we will be going on to Kings. What we said we're going to do, we're going to do not Kings, but Judges. I think we're going to Judges next, if I'm not mistaken. But we'll let you know the next chapter we're going to. So probably in the next week here, if you do want to just go with us with our next session, just send us your email address, and then we can send you the outline for the next section. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to jump right into it. All right. Oh, Heavenly Father, we thank you for the day. We thank you for the chance for us to gather again to study your word, oh Father. Oh Father, we thank you for you being you, the true triune God from which all grace flows, oh Father. Oh Father, we ask that you give a special blessing, oh Father, to those who are without power tonight, oh Father. Oh Father, let them know that you still have your caring arms around them, oh Father, even in the darkness, oh Father. We ask, oh Father, as we get ready to study your word, oh Father, that you soften our hearts, that you open our minds, you increase our understanding, oh Father, and as always, you add to our wisdom. We pray in your Son Jesus' name, amen. Amen. So, just to do a quick recap, so what has happened in the last couple chapters, Absalom came back from exile with the prompting of Joab, and so he was brought back from exile. He was without audience for the king for several years, and he finally got to the point where he thought this would be his chance to make a play for the throne. And he did it in a very, very, very calculated way. He started off by trying to winning the hearts of the people by proclaiming that he would be an advocate for them in the throne room, and also kind of being a man of the people as far as while David was preoccupied with the duties of the day. He went on to orchestrate this elaborate coup where he had some unwitting participants, and they went far off in what it looks like was a royal procession, since he had so many people with him, and he proclaimed himself through subterfuge as the king. When this happened, David knew that he did not want a civil war to happen in Jerusalem, so he gathered what officials he could, and they escaped. Then we see that Absalom moves into Jerusalem and takes over the palace. He also fulfills the thing that was told to David when he had his tryst with Bathsheba, that someone would come and lay with his wives in plain view. And so this turns out to be Absalom. So we're at the point right now where Absalom has gathered to himself some counselors. One of these counselors was one of David's men, and his whole position was to go to Absalom and confuse the counsel that Absalom got. So Ahithophel gave Absalom the counsel that he should go after David right away and overtake him. And of course, this man of David confused that counsel, and which gave David a chance to actually find out what tactic that Absalom was going to use, and gave him a chance to prepare for that coming conflict. This is something that David did not want. He'd already lost his son. Absalom was his favorite son. Absalom is his favorite son. We know now that Solomon, even though we know that from reading that he's going to be the king, he's far away from being of age to be the king. So this conflict would either leave David dead or it would leave Absalom dead. It's something that David did not want. And that's what we pick up here in chapter 18. And we're going to see the civil war begin to manifest. Brother Davis, you want to read that those first five chapters? I mean, first five verses.
Okay, in chapter 18.
Yes, sir.
Reading from the New King James Version, chapter 18, 1 through 5. And David numbered the people who were with him and set captains of thousands and captains of hundreds over them. Then David sent out one-third of the people under the hand of Joab, one-third under the hand of Abishai, the son of Zeruiah, Joab's brother, and one-third under the hand of Ittai, the Gittite. And the king said to the people, I also will surely go out with you myself. But the people answered, you should not go out. For if we flee away, they will not care about us, nor if half of us die, will they care about us. But you are worth 10,000 of us now, for you are now more help to us in this city. Then the king said to them, whatever seems best to you, I will do. So the king stood beside the gate, and all the people went out by hundreds and by thousands. Now the king had commanded Joab, Abishai, and Ittai, saying, deal gently for my sake with the young man Absalom. And all the people heard when the king gave all the captains order concerning Absalom. We are to the point that David is already putting forth his strategic effort to overthrow Absalom, to take away, which is not his kingdom yet, but he think is here, to let him know that it's only one king going to be in Jerusalem, that's David. So he already had the spies from the priests that was there. So he already knew what they was going to do.
Exactly.
And he and Hushai, which was the David's man, he knocked out what Ahithophel was talking about, and it made Ahithophel feel so bad because they were looking at his counselor as just next to God, you know. Mm-hmm. So when Hushai, Absalom asked him about it, what do you think? What are we all to do? And he made what Ahithophel null and void. So mm-hmm. Ahithophel looked at, wait a minute now, man. I know what's going to happen. So it's like he had because he was like a seer. So mm-hmm. he had a that sight that since they are not listening to me and they listen to Hushai, I already know that what's going to happen to Absalom. So in order, mm-hmm. He know that he was going to fall out of favor because mm-hmm. he's going to be branded as a traitor. Mm-hmm. So instead of him waiting till David kill him, of the people stoning, he decided to go and get his house in order because he didn't want them to take the riches from him. So he got his house in order and got his get make sure that his will was signed and his kids had this and that, and he hanged himself.
Mm-hmm.
He took his own life.
That's a great point you made. So,
yeah. So we got to the point where David is putting all the people in charge over the forces that he's gathered. Because he got them three.
Look, you went out, Brother Dave. You're on mute.
That's the strategist anyway.
Once he got that information, he knew how Absalom was going to come at him. So he put all his top people over. They gonna have a three-pronged attack. And he told them, look, he wanted to be with them, but the people talked him out of it. No, because they said, nah, we ain't about nothing, but you will be a target. You know, we don't, it probably would take more out of us to try to protect you if you were there than if you wasn't there. We can do what we need to do, you know, not worrying about the king. So he said, well, okay, I'll do it as the people tell him. But he made a plea to go soft on Absalom. He didn't want his generals to kill him, you know. And they said everybody heard what he said, but maybe something different that they actually took in.
And that's crazy that he's still looking out, because he's showing that love that he has for Absalom, mm-hmm. man. Even after what Absalom had done. And there's no doubt, you know, because that was a Ahithophel plan to just go up and, you know, and that was going to be the only person they were going to kill was going to be David. Because and David is just the opposite. He don't want to kill Absalom, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say that was a great point you was making about how Ahithophel knew, you know, that he had the best plan and that it probably would have worked. Or that it would definitely would have worked. They had executed it, but he knew that the way that if they took this out there, that David would definitely have a chance against them, because it's just if you think about it, it's a lot harder to just control a group that large, you know,
mm-hmm.
and Hushai had put them real at a real good disadvantage, because David took exactly what he said. He knew this large group moving slow, because you got all these people mm-hmm. with you. He split his men up and they were going to take them out. And he knew that they didn't have to take out a lot of them. He mm-hmm. just knew they had to do one good hit and it was going to break apart. You know, one good hit of these people, because he had the fighting men with him. The real tough fighting men with him. So he knew that if they could hit this inexperienced army, that they would fall apart. Yeah.
And that's one thing that Hushai was telling him, you know, he got buy-in man. You know, he got the best of the best. The cream of the crop with him. So, you know, but what actually he was setting it up for David all the time.
Mm-hmm.
He was actually setting up. And see, he didn't have the counsel of his affair was he was trying to give him, but you know, since he listened to Hushai put him in the bullseye.
Yeah, he did. And he made it sound real good too. Like, you mm-hmm. know, like, there wasn't no like no doubt. Yeah, what he's saying is true, you know. He mm-hmm. got the best of the men with him, but the strategy wasn't there. The strategy that would have won it wasn't there. Mm-hmm. So I was like you said, he was setting them up for the okie doke. That's exactly what was going to happen. Okay, I'm going to read 6 on down to 11.
Okay.
The army marched into the field to fight Israel, and the battle took place in the forest of Ephraim. There, the army of Israel was defeated by David's men, and the casualties of that day were great. 20,000 men. The battle spread out over the whole countryside, and the forest claimed more lives than sword. Absalom happened to meet David's men. He was riding his mule, and as the mule went under the thick branches of a large oak, Absalom's head got caught in the tree, and he was left hanging in midair while the mule he was riding kept on going. When one of the men saw this, they told Joab, "I just saw Absalom hanging in the oak tree." Joab said to the man who had told him this, "What? You saw him? Why didn't you strike him to the ground right there? Then I would have to give you 10 shekels of silver in a warrior's belt." So we see that one of David's great advantages was guerrilla warfare. You know, that's what he practiced mm-hmm. against Saul. And the technique he used here was to strike them hard, send them into disarray, and these men who weren't used to this guerrilla warfare or fighting in this unusual technique that Dave was using, the forest took more lives than the actual fighting did, because they didn't know how to mm-hmm. you know, they didn't know how to retreat in this unfamiliar territory, and they were scared, and they thought David might be around every corner, because they didn't mm-hmm. see, they didn't see him with Joab them, so they didn't know what David, they didn't know he had to be out here somewhere. So, but we also see Absalom, and if we remember back a few chapters ago, they would tell about how great his hair was, and how he had to cut it in a way, the way he so much, he had such wonderful hair. And that's the thing that got him all caught up. You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
Right in the battle with all this hair and got caught on the tree and yanked him white off his mule. And I just think it goes to show, you know, pride goes before the fall.
Mm-hmm.
And it was his pride that got him caught up in the end. Oh, and then old Joab. And
old Joab.
Now, Joab already knew what David had said, you know, don't touch his, treat Absalom with a soft glove. So the thing to do is Joab used to be was Absalom's advocate. The thing to do probably would be to cut him down, take him prisoner, take him to David, you know, and then let David deal with him the way that he should. And David probably had to kill him, but that should have been David called the mate. Absalom told the mate, you should have went on just gonna kill him. And because, you know, well, Joab said that, you know, Joab, you know, that's this plan for after everything, just go ahead and kill him in the field. And we're gonna see what the guy's answer is gonna be. You want
to
add
that? And then another thing, Brother Griff, see, Joab would have rubber for that guy to go ahead and kill him.
Yes, exactly.
He actually told the generals that, and not everybody else. You know, but they heard it. But you know, it would go easier on them on that him saying, well, he didn't know exactly what was going on. So you know,
he definitely would have had cover if the guy would have went on and killed him. And he's like, man, yeah, you know, what can we say, David? It was battle. He didn't know if he was supposed to save him. But if maybe we hung that dude out to dry, Joab would have been nowhere around.
Joab had his own agenda too. Mm. You know, he even though he wanted Absalom back, but since Absalom took this route,
exactly,
you know, he kind of played against what he probably was planning with his own thing. You know, you messing it up for me, man.
Yeah, he probably felt a little ire that Absalom had took that route when all he really had to do was probably just wait for the kingdom and it would have been healed anyway.
And then another thing, Griff, and then Joab probably was a little jealous too, because he didn't consult him on that. You know, Joab was his uncle, right?
I think it would have been his cousin, but he was taking an uncle, a mentor.
Yeah, because he, yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And you know, I'm the one that begged for you to be back, that made a whole big plan to get you back. And you didn't even consult me on this right here matter. And then you put somebody else in charge as a general. Oh man, look, I'm gonna show you then. Show you that you messed up on that part, man.
Yeah.
So he had an agenda too.
He was definitely on the wrong side of Joab at this point. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So Joab had a selective hearing. He didn't hear the king. He wanted, I'm gonna take him out, man. He told that guy, and then even said what he would have gave him. So to keep that on your mind if you run into him again. I'm gonna give you 10 shekels of silver. So you would have had that in your belt already. So hopefully you probably going, hey man, speak that to somebody else, man. Y'all get him, y'all see him first, go on, take him on out, man. King got a gift for you. I mean, Joab gonna give you a gift. Yeah, we see that the doors are closing and the windows are being shut.
Yeah. All right. So you want to read from 12 on down to 18?
Okay. But the man said to Joab, though I were to receive 1,000 shekels of silver in my hand, I would not raise my hand against the king's son. For in our hearing, he let him know that I heard that the king commanded you and Abishai and Ittai, saying, beware, lest anyone touch the young man Absalom. Otherwise, I would have dealt falsely against my own life. That means I ain't no fool now. But there is nothing hidden from the king, and you yourself would have set yourself against me. Don't even play me like that. Don't even let him know. Then Joab said, I cannot linger with you. And And he took three spears in his hand and thrust them. And he took three spears in his hand and thrust them through Absalom's heart while he was still alive in the midst of the tabernacle tree. You should stop where now?
You're going to stop at 18.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And 10 young men who bore Joab's armor surrounded Absalom and struck and killed him. So Joab blew the trumpet, and the people returned from pursuing Israel, for Joab held back the people. And they took Absalom and cast him into a large pit in the woods and laid a very large heap of stones over him. Then all Israel fled, everyone to his tent. Now Absalom in his lifetime had taken and set up a pillar for himself, which is in the king's valley. For he said, I have no son to keep my name in remembrance. He called the pillar after his own name, and to this day it is called Absalom's monument. You said stop right there, right?
Yeah, stop right there. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. That just shows you, man, that Joab did not look, man, I'm gonna kill this guy. He didn't worry about what the king said. Because I thought that even after hearing what this guy said, because the guy said that we all heard him just like you did, you know. And I'm not gonna fall a victim to me doing it, then you blaming me for it and killing me or having the king kill me, you know. So I heard what he said, but Joab's like, man, this war, you know? Mm-hmm. And he did this to the king, and I'm gonna take care of it. So he thrust him with the three spears, but he didn't kill him, because they said the guys struck and killed him after they surrounded him, his armor bearers. Struck and killed. They want to make sure he was dead, look like.
Yeah, I think they call that overkill. They want to make sure he was dead. Yeah,
because he had already struck him in his heart. So Absalom, he said he thrust three spears. He said he took three spears in his hand and thrust them through Absalom's heart while he was still alive in the midst of it. He didn't take him out the tree. He like target practice while he was still hanging by his hat. And then the other guy, his armor bar, they struck him and killed him. And then threw him in a, then he blew the trumpet to let everybody know that the job was done. We didn't get it. And then he said, everybody fled to his tent. And, you know, and one thing about that whole thing, Absalom was preparing for his own demise just in case it don't work out.
Exactly.
Because he actually had built himself his own gravestone. You know, I'm already put my monument down. Says I don't have anybody to take carry on my name. I'm putting my monument here, you know, just in case something happened to him. This they'll know that this is Absalom. This is what happened, you know. He wanted to continue to, whatever he thought was greatness, he wanted to continue his enemies too. You know, add anything to that, Brother Grill?
No, it makes me wonder how Joab thought that he was going to get away with that, you know? Because, I mean, he went directly against the orders of the king. And I guess part of his shit would have been that it was war. You know, we had to do what we had to do to start a revolt. I guess part of it was because, you know, he was family too. And he knew that David dealt, you know, dealt unevenly with his family and that he was other people. But it just makes me wonder how he felt like, you know, there wasn't going to be no retaliation behind that.
He didn't care. It sounded to me still, I'd say, that just by Absalom not conferring with him on that matter that he had taken a hand. Now, I don't know if he would have actually won against David. He may have tried to talk him out of it. But I think that it was a slight.
The fact that he didn't come to me, and I'm the one.
You didn't come to me at all. I'm the one that was responsible for getting you back. You know, so you kicked me to the curb. You didn't give me no kind of consideration. And then you put another guy over your army? That's disrespectful to me. Yeah. I think he was a little upset with that. And he was planning on killing it. You know,
I think it was a lot of personal hate. No, yeah.
Huh?
I think with a lot of personal hate behind that, maybe he didn't care. Maybe he didn't care how it was going to turn out. You know, he would have got his revenge. You know, if it went south, I still got my revenge.
And then you got to look at and go back to Brother Griff. Absalom burnt his fields up. Yeah, see, because he wouldn't give attention. See, because I think Joab saying, look, I seen the king in mourning and grief, man. You know, things are going wrong within him. So I figured that I'll bring you back because I understand what happened, why you did what you did, you know. Mm. And you decided to flee because you thought the king would probably go after you anyway. So, but the king's heart was soft and he loved you, man. You were his favorite. So once he got over the death of his other son, and even though he was at your hand, he really longed to talk to you. You know, he didn't want to talk to you right away, but he longed for his son. So Joab took it into his hand and said, okay, I don't want to see the king like this, you know. So he went on and devised a plan to get you back. And then once I got you back, you want my attention. And I didn't, because I know I'm knowing that it's foolishness. You just got back. Get a king time and everything gonna be just like you want. But no, you want to burn up my fields and then act like that I'm just was not nothing. And I'm the one got you back here. I think he was kind of upset by all that. You know. Now I don't know what would have happened if the man burnt his fields up, because he said, well, I was trying to get your attention. So I decided to get. And so I think that he, when Absalom set orders for his fields to be burnt up to get his attention, that actually made Joab upset that you would go to that extreme to get my attention.
Yeah. And you know, another thing is that Joab might was thinking clearer than David, because how could this whole thing end? It couldn't end unless one of them was dead. You know, one of them was going to have to be dead for this to end. Because as long as Absalom was alive, there were people who would say, man, you know, Absalom should be king, you know. It would have been always that lingering in their mind that you know, he really should be the king. David ran off, you know, and Absalom was held the thing pretty good. And so he knew that for this war to end, that one of them would have been dead.
There you go. I think I go along with that. Because, you know, and then he knew David's heart.
Man. Yeah, he knew David's heart.
The whole family knew David's heart. They knew David was soft.
He wasn't going to be able to do it.
He was soft for his family. So, he probably said, look, man, this is not going to work out. What he talking about, being soft on this guy, and this guy taking all the, trying to take the whole kingdom, and then having people in disarray. You know, that may play bad on the people, because, you know, David already said there ain't some of the people coming back to them. So how can I even be a general over disenfranchising within the ranks already? Mm-hmm. So I got to get this guy out the way. Because if he did it one time, he probably do it again.
We're going to stop him. Wait till his hair grew back. He been back in the shadows again.
Yeah, buddy.
All right, we're going to go a little bit further. I'm going to read 19 through, let's see. I'll read through 23, yeah.
Okay.
Now, Ahimaaz, son of Zadok, said, let me run and take the news to the king that the Lord has delivered him from the hand of his enemies. You are not the one to take the news today, Joab told him. You may take the news another time, but you must not do so today, because the king's son is dead. King's son is dead.
Yeah, 21.
Then Joab said to a Cushite, go tell the king what you have seen. The Cushite bowed down
before Joab and ran off. Amon's son of Zadok again said to Joab, come with me, please let me run behind the Cushite. But Joab replied, my son, why did you want to go? You don't have any news that will bring you a reward. He said, come with me, I want to run. So Joab said, run. The Amaz ran by way of the plain and outran the Cushite. So I don't know the reason that Joab was reluctant to let Amaz bear the news of the death of David. I don't think that he had his whole plan together yet of what he was going to tell David. Mm-hmm. So he was going to let the Cushite go, because the Cushite really didn't know what all happened to Absalom. He knew he was dead, but he didn't know all what happened to Absalom. So maybe if he would let the Cushite go and let him deal the blow that Absalom was dead, then he could have got the story together, and then he could have came to David and let him know what had happened. Amaz went out, and he's going to run out, and he overtook the Cushite, so he's going to make it to David before the Cushite does.
He had a plan, didn't he? Mm-hmm. He was planning on outrunning him anyway. Mm-hmm. But I agree with you on that. Joab decided, you know, he didn't have all his marbles lined up yet. Mm-hmm. So wait a minute now, you don't know everything had gone, you know, and the king's son's dead, you know. So sometimes we'll let our emotions get in the way of, you know, I want him dead. But then after we do the job, then we get to thinking, man, what I'm going to do? I know how this king going to feel about his son and, you know, all that's coming to play now. And what I'm going to tell him, you know. And these guys want to run. No, oh, man, you don't know the news yet. You know, the king's son and passed. Well, that's the main news. You know, that's not what I want you to tell him yet.
Yeah, so exactly. Let me
let this slow running brother get that work. I can come up with a plan, you know. Mm-hmm. And then this man right here was adamant about, I actually thought I'd read it. I said, I don't guess you all gonna try to kill that brother. You and adamant about running. Nah, quitting.
I forgot I want you to run ahead. We're gonna get rid of you right now. I wonder what he did to the other guy though, the guy that wouldn't strike down Absalom. I wonder if did he kill that guy, you know?
The man said, why would you run, my son, since you have no news ready? You know, he said, no news ready. You ain't got to I'm gonna spend this thing now. I mean, like Jim Denzel said in let me quarterback this thing first, man. It ain't ready yet, man, you know? So, but the guy said, okay, I guess he was persistent. So Joab said, what's going on, man? But this guy, he's a runner. You know, it makes me think about, what's that guy, David's son, that was running after the king, and Joab had to go and kill him?
Turn aside,
he's a runner like him. He was not going to be denied. Okay. Let me run. So he told him, we're going to run, man.
Mm-hmm.
So he outran. Because he all the time, they said he ran by the way of the plane. Mm-hmm. You see, this other guy just was going to run straight ahead, but he ran another route.
I think that he was the dedicated runner messenger for Jerusalem. So that's what he did. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? That he knew the exact route to go to get the message there the quickest.
Quickest, uh-huh.
Yeah,
and then you got to think, why did he want to get it there the quickest? I think he got something on his sleeve. Oh, that sounds like. Yeah, I want the king to know this just in case this man try to, you know, do something different. I want to be the first to tell him.
Okay, let's go a little bit farther. Why don't you read 24 to 27.
Okay. Now David was sitting between the two gates. And the watchman went up to the roof over the gate to the wall, lifted his eyes and looked, and there was a man running along. Then the watchman cried out and told the king. And the king said, if he is alone, there is news in his mouth. And he came rapidly and drew near. Then the watchman saw an other man running. And the watchman called to the gatekeeper and said, there is another man running alone. And the king said, he also brings news. So the watchman said, I think the running of the first is like the running of Ahimanaz, the son of Zadok. And the king said, he is a good man and comes with good news. So Ahimanaz called out and said to the king, all is well. Then he bowed down with his face to the earth before the king and said, blessed be the Lord your God, who has delivered up the men who raised their hand against my lord the king. The king said, is the young man Absalom safe? And Ahimanaz answered, when Joab sent the king's servant and me your servant, I saw a great tumult, but I did not know what it was about. And the king said, turn aside and stand here. So he turned aside and stood still. Just then the Cushite came, and the Cushite said, there is good news, my lord the king, for the Lord has avenged you this day and of all those who rose against you. What do you tell me to stop at?
I'm just gonna go ahead. You can go ahead and read that part.
Okay. Okay. And the king said to the Cushite, is the young man Absalom safe? So the Cushite answered, may the enemies of my lord the king and all who rise against you to do harm be like that young man.
Go ahead. We can go ahead and finish it all out.
Then the king. You know, he ain't just, he kind of stuck it in a little bit because he ain't just telling me what day he's to be like that man.
Yeah.
May all of them be like him. Then the king was deeply moved and went up to the chamber over the gate and wept. And as he went, he said, thus, O my son Absalom, my son Absalom, if only I had died in your place. O Absalom. My son. They didn't really want to get a king that bad news.
They didn't. That's why he picked the Cushite. He picked the foreigner. And I don't know if the foreigner knew who Absalom was, you know. So if the foreigner had came by himself, David might not have asked him about Absalom. He kind of figured that he know who Absalom was. Because nobody said that man is dead, you know what I'm saying? But
and he was letting them know all the rest of them need to go just to
go.
He
go
went.
Like him too. Yeah. He didn't say with no emotion because he wasn't of the nation of Israel, you know. He didn't know the backstory.
Yeah, he went trying to be sensitive to David at all when he said it.
No.
He said, because the rest of them, he would ask him, is he still alive? He said, he didn't answer him right then as a yes or no. But he said, who all of them need to have went, all of them that rose against you should have went just like he did. David already knew what that was. Now, I don't know if that was the plan for that Joab sent him, you know, that he ain't going to care. You know, he gonna put it in that way. But David said, I wish it had been me. He was hurt by that.
He was.
You know, he made inquiries about who did it, Jay. He just hurt. He just hollered his son's name out. And he's really grieving because he was grieving that I wish he had to did this. I longed for him so long. And it said, I wish it had been my own life that to be given. And I'm quite sure, man, all this right here that has happened before him, man, and then he just reliving everything that God told him.
He tracked it back to that sin. He tracked it back to that sin he did with Bathsheba and killing and killing her husband and all that, and he know that, you know, if but for that sin, he wouldn't be here right now. You know, mm-hmm. he wouldn't be in this predicament. Because all that was done was what God had predicted. You know, that what would happen from the fruits of that sin he did with Bathsheba, man. And it's coming all down on his head.
Mm-hmm. Just that moment of lust mm-hmm. turned into just shame and just a sinful nature. And now, and just like Nathan told him, he ain't gonna kill you. He ain't gonna kill you, but you gonna suffer. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, boy, that suffer almost make you pray for death.
It does,
and that seemed
man.
Like what he was doing, you know?
Yeah.
Man, I wish it had been me. And then my son gone, his sister's been disrespected, and she's not a virgin anymore. I mean, woo, boy, when you said turn your playhouse inside out, man, don't mess with the father, man. Be an obedient, cause you don't nothing get past him. He see you coming and you're going. He already know your mind, whatever, before you even make it up, he already know it. So David is feeling this. You know, sometimes it's hard for us to see and feel. We just do.
We do.
When it happens to us, we so hurt by it.
Mm-hmm.
But that's what's going on. He already took. And see, we don't know. We already know what we do from just being sinful. You know, mm-hmm. It's a payment for that. But yeah. It's hard for sometimes that, like, yeah, God right in your midst, and he sent the prophet to let you know. Because then you have to look it up. If somebody tell you, if you don't do what you supposed to be doing, God has already gave you a marching plan through your prayer.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you had a dream, and in your dream, it was written out the plan that God had for your life and what he wanted you to do. And you, this what you prayed on now. And now he got a plan for that, what he wants for you. And you stray away from that, you know, well, I can do this. I'm still, you know, I'm still going, no, that's not what you prayed about. And that's not what, that was not your assignment.
Mm-hmm.
Now, since you've been disobedient and you disobeyed what you asked for, this is what's going to happen to you, you know. And when it happened, you know, you may not look at it. David kind of felt what was going to happen because it hadn't happened yet. And he said, you know, I think I'm going to have a gain favor with it, you know. You're doing all right, but hey, man, I told you what was going on. I'm not you, you know. You sought that to heart. And even though you know they need, you know your kids need punishment, you look the other way.
Mm-hmm.
No, God ain't said, I'm when I tell you I'm going to punish you, you're going to get it.
You're going to get it.
I'm going to have to whoop you into shape.
Mm-hmm. And so they took it to the woodshed.
Yes, sir.
And I mean, it's like, it shows you, man, that sin, sometimes it can give you a double whammy, you know, because, mm-hmm. you know, he got hit that first, immediate hit, you know, when with the death of the child, but you know that wasn't the end of it. You know what I'm saying? It was gonna be an echo of death, and it was an echo of death through his family because of what he had done. You know, and it's with all sins, you know, the penalty is death, but this was just a ultimate visualization of it. You know, that sin with Bathsheba. It took so much death. It took her husband. It took the baby.
Oh,
took
man,
his first son. He just, then took his other son. Man. You know, and it was all predicated on that sin.
And it just showed God disappointment in David. What he had, mm-hmm. you know, this was a man after my own heart, man. And mm-hmm. when you do that, and then to, you know, you already sinned with the man's wife, but to mm-hmm. Try to set you set up her husband to die.
Yeah.
You try to, first of all, that whole thing that you know, he wouldn't do what you wanted him to do because of his loyalty to you. Mm. That you didn't see nothing in that.
Mm.
You know, that probably, you know, that may have made God upset more than
even
anything.
More than anything.
That this
you know?
Man was, he was so loyal and so dedicated to you that he wouldn't even do what you told him to do, because he didn't see, he seen unrighteousness in what you looked at it was your command for him to do what you told him to do. I don't want to go, I just can't go back to the house and have make love to my wife. Why? The men are out here dying for you, because I love you that much. I want to put my life on the line. That's why I need to be at King. She tried to get him drunk. I mean, all the things, all the evil things that David was thinking to do.
Yep.
Because he wouldn't do what you want him to do.
Just to cover his sin. Just to
cover your sin. So, you know, a lot of times, bro, we don't look at the things that he probably looked at. David looking at all the things that's afflicting him, but not all the things that you did. So your things were just as worse.
Convoluted. Convoluted.
One led
sin.
To the other. One led to the other, man. And, you know, that's what we get, man. We have to continue to try to be better and try to, whatever that the plan that God has for your life, you got to try to, you know, stay on top, stay within that plan. You know, we living in a sinful world, but when God give you marching orders, man, you better do what he tell you to do. Because, you know.
I think, man, sometimes we have to stop and we have to consider the lasting repercussions of that sin, you know. It's going to echo even into eternity, you know, and we have to we have to consider that. And a lot of times when we do that, man, we're like, man, it just ain't worth it.
instead of wages of sins of death, and then what, you know, God will hit you for the second and third generation, man. It may not directly be on you, but to make you suffer. Because, you know, you have people that will do tragic things out there, and people like, man, how this guy right here get away with all that? Yeah, you may think he's getting away with it, and then all of a sudden, the same low-down, dirty, evil stuff that he used to do to people, and he a changed man now. That befalls his favorite son and his daughter. And he suffered for that, you know? Hey, man, we don't get away with nothing, man. You know, so change your evil ways, man. Be better. Be a better person. Got to think on doing that all the time. What all can right. I do to make myself better and make society better?
Well, we're going to pick up with chapter 19 next time. Brother Dave, y'all got anything going on at your church?
No, we don't have anything going on. No, because we get some repairs done, roof and everything. So, no, we don't have anything special going on right now. We had another church visiting from St. Louis, most of the Dumb and White Church. We come in it was last Sunday. We come in last Sunday, boy, we were packed out. I'm like, wow.
That's good, man.
We got a small congregation, man. It was packed out in there, but they looking and, you know, they enjoyed it. One thing about our church, we most definitely friendly, man. So, you know.
That's great.
And I think some of them people still here, because I see on Facebook that we had some of the people still there. I wasn't there last week. My wife and I had took grandkids. We first road trip.
Okay, where do you guys go to?
Panama Beach, Florida.
That's nice. How the grandkids
is? I've never done a road trip like that in my life. I've ain't drove no more than Little Rock, Arkansas.
Okay.
You know, but that was our first time, man. And my wife said, "Where your faith at?" I said, "My faith is that I just had never did it." You know?
Well, my kids were smaller. We used to do it all the time, man.
Oh, really?
And I had a chance to do it one more time with them. When they got older, I think my son had just graduated from high school.
Oh, okay.
And my daughter, you know, she was up in age too. And we did kind of like a circuit. We started it in Nashville, then we went to Chattanooga, then we went down to Atlanta, and we came back through Birmingham. You know, we did a circuit. road trip over a few days, man.
And oh,
they really, I thought they would complain about it, but I guess they really enjoyed it because they still talk about it now.
Oh, okay, yeah. Hey, look at that. And see, my grandkids had never seen a beach before.
That's
see,
great.
Other man. Than television.
Mm.
And they did with 13, 12, and 5.
That's nice.
So they, you know, they really knew, and that weather was kicking a little bit, so they seen the true power. I was telling about the power of God. You see it right there. You know, because we looked at the beach one day, the next day we go, oh, that's covered up with water. They were like, wow, what is laying in? And, oh, man, that's how God is. His own way.
All right. But we're going to have a few things up on the YouTube page here in the next couple of days. We're going to do the last couple sessions. I'm going to get those put up. Okay. I preached yesterday my initial sermon at Mount Olive. I'm going to put that the snippets from that up too. I think
that was at your church.
It was at my church, yeah. So
I didn't know he. I didn't know that was already, you had already did that. I know he had went to the, y'all were having a
wedding,
friends and family day.
Yeah, we had friends and family day. That was the week before last. They did that. They're having revival starting Sunday the 9th. I think they're going to do it 19th and 11th. Starting 5 o'clock Sunday evening, but we'll get that information up. There's a lot of things going on in Memphis and around here in northern Mississippi. We're going to try to keep track as much as we can, visit as much as we can. If anybody watching, you have something going on, you want us to mention it, just shoot us a line and we can do it. We're going to do something with our own ministry here in a little bit. We did our track thing, but I think we got something else in mind that we're going to try to do here. Coming up, and it may be something virtual, but we're going to try to get that online too. All right, Brother Davis, you want to pray us out?
Yeah, I pray us out. Bow your heads. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you, Father, for allowing us to gather here in your holy name, Father, just to just preach your gospel, Father, just to let the dying world know, Father, that God is still in control, Father. You are who you are, your greatest. We always would just keep you on our hearts and minds, Father. We ask your blessings over our family and our friends, Father, and that we can continue to have this platform, Father, to bring the good news, Father, of your son, Jesus. We love you, Father, and we praise your holy name. In your son, Jesus' name, we pray. Amen.
Amen. All right, Brother David, see you next week, man.
All right, my brother, you be blessed now.
All right, you too.
All right, then.